Hey, what's going on YouTube? I just bought these used batteries from a website called Battery Clearinghouse. This video isn't sponsored, but I got them for a good deal because these are used and hopefully we can recover most of them with good capacity. And we're going to be building a small compact e-bike battery for my project. This is going to be my second battery build. Right here is my first one. And I used a mix of cells just to see what it was like to wire, use the spot welder. And today I'm going to show you all those skills using these LG MH1 cells, and we're going to build a 10S 4P battery, which is a standard size for 36 volt e-bike. And so to begin, we need to go ahead and cut these packs apart. Now, I already went and measured out these packs here. You see we have four different packs, and these are actually 10S 3P packs. So I have about 120 18650 cells here. I measured the voltage on all four of these packs and found that two of them are reading at 40 volts and two of them are reading at exactly 8 volts. That means that two of these battery packs are below their normal storage voltage, which means there may have been some damage to the capacity, but sometimes this can be less than 1% of its total capacity from being stored below their storage voltage for just one cycle. So we're gonna bring these back up to their regular voltages. We're gonna test their capacities using the Opus smart charger and then only use the high grade cells. You can also see that some of these batteries here, they do have the missing shrink wrap around them. I think they said when they disassemble the packs, there's some glue here that pulls off the shrink wrap around the individual cells. So some cells we're going to have to rewrap with shrink wrap. We don't want them short circuiting at all by touching each other or should something metal or a wire slip in there. And now without further ado, let's get to work. Now we're gonna start by disassembling the packs and separating the cells from the rest of the boards, the PCB boards and the BMS. Now this battery pack, it has some hidden screws behind these rubber covers here. Once I've removed those screws, I'm able to use some plastic pry tools to get the batteries out of their protective casing. And you wanna be real gentle doing this because they are glued in and you don't want to damage, puncture, or bend any of the cells removing them, because then you wouldn't be able to use them in the future. And some of them were already damaged, like I said before, so let's try not to damage anymore. The batteries are encased in these PCB boards, which have nickel strips both soldered to the board and then welded to the battery. And that makes it kind of a pain to remove and recover these cells, but that's part of why we got them for a good deal. Once we've removed all of the nickel strips, there's a screw at the bottom here that holds a dowel compressing all these batteries together. And with that screw removed, we can go ahead and separate these individual modules with the batteries inside of them. Now we're moving on to the cell recovery portion of this process, and this is something that's universal for all battery packs that people might disassemble in order to recover cells from. In my case, I'm using a small pair of snips, these are flush end pliers, to gently remove the nickel strips while making sure that I don't create any shorts by touching the nickel strips together to form a closed loop. That would short the batteries and you could cause a fire or explosion. And to save myself some time, I'm going to remove as much of the nickel strip as possible with my pliers before moving to the next step.
Now, as you can see, I have two batteries disassembled completely down to the individual cells. There's still a little bit of metal here that we're going to have to grind off later, but I wanted to start capacity testing these cells to get an idea of their condition. And as you can see here, 3.280 amp hours is a huge capacity for these batteries. I think they're actually rated at 3 amp hours new. So that tells us that these cells are in really good condition. Honestly, I was expecting less than 3 amp hours capacity per cell. If you're trying to find out what the internal capacity is of your cells, especially used cells, you're gonna have to get like a smart charger, like the one that I have here, and it'll actually measure from the top of the voltage to the bottom of the voltage range and tell you what capacity is in that battery. And what we're going to do is we're going to try to mix and match these to have about the average same internal capacity of these cell groups, which should be around 12 or 13 amp hours, so that no individual cell group drains faster than the rest. That would cause basically a shorter range on your e-bike, and it would really put a huge load on this BMS system in order to balance all the groups. Next up, let's go ahead and 3D print our case, and then we'll assemble the new batteries after we clean them up a little bit more, and then we'll get into the fun stuff of taking this battery out for a ride. Now, as you can see here, I'm grinding off the remaining bits of nickel strip that were still on the ends of the batteries, and that way we have a perfectly smooth surface to install our new nickel strip for our battery. After that, we're going to capacity test them, and this is a great opportunity for us to also sort out the bad batteries that have a diminished capacity. If it has less than 80% capacity as it did new, then you should probably recycle it. Now, as far as parts needed for this build, you will need a BMS system like the one I have here, and also your 18650 cells of choice. Here are the specs for the MH1 cells that I'm going to be using today. And now to put all the batteries together, you will need something like this case or layout in order to get all the batteries organized. What I've done is 3D printed my own battery case, and this will keep all the cells individually spaced to allow a little bit of ventilation and also ensure the safety of this battery and make sure that it's all really tightly squeezed together. Now, when you're assembling the battery pack, you want to make sure that each parallel series of cells is approximately the same capacity, and that way not one drains faster than the other. Something like the tool that I'm showing you here will make it easy for you to assemble your pack, and all you have to do is just put all the cells that you have in there. And then once you've got the correct layout and all the cells in the right order, you can go ahead and slap on the other side of your battery case, and now we can begin welding the nickel strips on. So part of this process involves using a spot welder, and the one that I bought is probably the most affordable one that you can find on Amazon. The downside being that it doesn't exactly have enough power to weld thicker nickel strips. So as far as building a high discharge battery, it's probably not going to be the best spot welder, but it's going to work for the purposes that we have here. And folks, I wish I had enough time and knowledge to share with you guys all of the different ways that you could possibly mess up building a battery, because this is something that you do not want to mess with if you are not aware of what you're doing. I would recommend watching as many YouTube videos as possible, reading articles online, and do lots of research before you start this process. And yes, I'm aware that my battery welds did not come out perfect. In fact, I had to pull off a couple of strips and start over, but I think it's going to be safe enough for what we're using today. And the important part is that practice makes perfect. In this particular battery, we do have to use a pyramid style connection, and this is basically just stacking on nickel strips in a way that will allow plenty of amps to cross from one series to the other, specifically from series 5 to series 6, and that way you don't have any hot spot in the nickel where too many amps are trying to flow through too small of a path. Now, once our battery is done being built, you just want to go ahead and measure out the voltage, make sure you don't have anything funny going on, and then we can go ahead and start wrapping the battery as well as installing our BMS system. The paper that I'm using here that you see a lot of people using in their e-bike batteries is called fish paper. It's like twice as thick as cardstock, and it's made to keep the battery leads and the balance wires from getting in contact with anything on the battery itself, which, you know, could cause a short circuit. So you definitely want to make sure you're using this in your battery as a safety precaution. And also some other things like Clapton tape are really useful to make those wires tidy and make sure that they don't go in any place where they shouldn't. You can also see here that I am putting a little drop of solder onto the parallel connections so that our BMS system will be able to track the voltages of each bank of cells and also balance out the cells while charging. And that's going to be vital to ensuring the longevity of this battery. Now the battery is almost complete. We've completed the balance wires for the BMS system, but now what we're going to do is add a charge port and a discharge port. I chose an XD60 because it's one that I'm familiar with, and since this is a common port BMS system, they will charge and discharge out of the same two wires. So we'll go ahead and check the voltage reading here from the discharge port to make sure it's exactly the same as it was before the BMS system, and that confirms that our BMS is wired correctly. Now, as far as finishing touches, we will be using shrink wrap to make sure that all the wires and all the batteries stay really tightly packed together, that there's no movement, because that could cause problems with things rubbing together in the future. And I also 3D printed some end caps for the battery, which is going to give it a little bit of structural rigidity as well as kind of seal off the sides of the battery, because I didn't buy another larger shrink wrap to go around it long ways.
So with the battery completely shrink wrapped, you want to make sure that your discharge port is in the correct position so that it'll reach the controller for your bike. And that is basically a completed build. This was later installed in my MX350 that I gave to my best friend, and he really enjoys the bike. The battery fits in perfectly and puts out just enough power for the 350 watt motor. Actually, I think the battery could do a little bit of a bigger motor and controller setup, but for now, I think that the bike is really fun, and I know that my friends enjoy it too. So if you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to drop a like down below. Leave any comments with questions or, you know, feedback on my battery build and what you did on yours. And consider subscribing to the channel if you want to see more cool e-bike content like this. As always, I hope you guys have an amazing day, and we'll see you in the next video.
Through the grass. Ow!